working back after that? Well, sir opted for a voluntary retirement from the prestigious AIIMS New Delhi in pursuit of a greater meaning in life. Sir is a medical scientist, a prolific writer, an inspirational speaker, and a great teacher. He has authored more than 200 scientific papers, popular articles, and 25 books, including the much-loved Understanding Medical Physiology. I consider myself extremely fortunate to be one of Sir's students, and I'm really glad that our first-year students will be able to get a glimpse of Sir's great oratory skills. Thank you, sir, for accepting our invitation and agreeing to conduct this session for our students. Without much delay, I hand over the stage to Professor Ramesh Lal Bijlani. Thank you.
Thank you, Mansi and Abhishek. My dear boys and girls, I'm always happy to talk to young people, particularly medical students. Young people, because they are the future, and medical students, because they have a multiplier effect. What they learn gets passed on also to their patients, and they become all, if they also become teachers like Mansi and me, also to their students. So that is why I like it. But just to sort of start with an interesting way, why I like talking to young people, to illustrate that, I generally tell a story. Everybody likes stories, so let's start with one. Once there was a group of four people with a hand-driven cart. You know, you must have seen those, you know, primitive carts made of wood, two people pulling it on one side and two pushing it on the other. And on this was some big, heavy cupboard. And these people had to deliver it in some house. They had the address on a small piece of paper, and they were going on showing the street as they went to find out where it had to be delivered. Finally, they found somebody who told them that now you are very near. Look at those buildings, high-rise buildings. If you go to that one on the 11th floor, you'll find this house. So they went there. They went to the building which they thought had been pointed out. When they went inside, they found that there was a lift, but it was too small for the cupboard. So they started taking the cupboard through the staircase. They were very tired very soon. They got exhausted. And then they kept the cupboard on one side. And one of them went to one of the apartments at random and just rang the bell to find out how much more they had to climb. He came back after making the inquiry and told his friends, "Friends, I have some good news for you and some bad news. The good news is that we are on the 10th floor. Then what is the bad news?" I'm sure many of you have guessed. I find generally young people these days are very smart. But since this is not a live audience, it's not easy for you, me to get the answer from you. The bad news is that we are in the wrong building. We had to go to the next one. And now you can understand what they would be feeling. Now, the reason why I told you this story is that if a person like me at my age now discovers that all my life I have been walking along the wrong path, and now I discover the right one, I'll be in a position similar to these people on the 10th floor. By the time I retrace my steps and get onto the right path, I'll be dead and gone. With you, it is very different. It's like, you know, being on the first floor. Even if it's the wrong building, doesn't matter. You have all the energy to quickly come down and get into the right one. You hardly gone to the first floor because you have not had much time in life to make many mistakes. And on top of that, being young, you have a tremendous capacity to learn new things, and your way of living, way of life, has not become rigid. And you can change yourself and make use of the knowledge which you get about how to live, because that may require a change. You know, change is something which we all in general resist. We want the things to continue as they are. At the most, we want some minor adjustments. But then On one hand, we want to progress. On one hand, we want to improve. And on the other, we don't want to change. All progress depends upon change. Getting better means better than we are now. That requires a change. So that is the paradox. So since all progress, all improvement means basically a change from where we are to something better, something higher, we require change. And that is something which is much easier for young people. They're open to change. And that's why I enjoy talking to young people. And when I start, you'll find that I'm not really talking much about medicine. I'm talking about life. But then the two cannot be divorced, especially for you people, because as young doctors, you'll find that out of the 24 hours that you have in a day, which constitutes your daily life, you'll hardly get one third of that, that is 8 hours to sleep. And sometimes for all the remaining 16 hours, you are on duty as a doctor. And therefore, the real waking life is professional life. And therefore, if you understand life, you also understand how to spend those 16 hours and to some extent, also how to spend the remaining 8 hours when you are asleep. So first, we'll start with talking about life and then connect it to medicine. So with this little background, let me go to the PPTs, the slides. Hey, one screen. ये सारी क्यों आ गई? मैंने तो एक ही खोली हुई थी. Have I been able to do it right? Can you see the slide?
Yes, sir. We can see, sir.
Okay. So the topic you already know. Caring professions includes the medical profession and also professions like nursing, physiotherapy, counseling, etc., etc. Because these are the professions which basically are meant to care for others, those who are in some sort of difficulty. Before I go further, let me bring to all of you the love and blessings of the Mother and Sri Aurobindo, the two spiritual masters who have inspired the place where I live and work. Life may be compared to a journey. As I told you, we'll start with life. Life may be compared to a journey, and that's a cliche. Everybody understands that life basically is starts with birth and ends with death. And between these two events, we have the journey called life. We'll carry this cliched comparison a little further and in some depth. Now, in the journey of life, who is the driver? We ourselves are the drivers. And the first basic requirement in any journey is that the driver should be physically and mentally fit. And what makes a person physically and mentally fit is something which you'll keep learning at least for the next 5 years. And even that does not really mean the end of learning. You'll keep learning all your life and still may not know everything, because the fact is that the world itself does not know everything that we need to do to stay healthy. All the same, we keep learning more and more throughout life, and that helps. And therefore, since this is something which basically you are in the medical school for, we'll not go into how to be physically and mentally healthy. That is how the driver of our own life can be fit so that he can do the job properly. So let's assume that the driver has become physically and mentally fit. The next important thing in the journey is the vehicle. Now, if it were a live session, I would ask you, how important is a vehicle in the journey? And the usual answer that I get is, it's very important. And then when I ask why it is important, the usual answer is that some vehicles are faster and some vehicles are more comfortable and so on. But what is the most important thing in a vehicle? Not being comfortable or fast, but its ability to take us from one place to the other. For example, if it is hot, it would be nice if we are in an air-conditioned car, but then we are not there basically for the air conditioning. We can be equally comfortable in an air-conditioned room. The car is there to take us from one place to the other. And therefore, the vehicle, if we think of it in terms of its capacity to take us from where we are to our destination, is not very important. You know, just try to understand this point. Our ability to reach our destination is not critically dependent on the type of vehicle we have. Which means that if we know where we have to go, even a bicycle will take us there. But if we don't know where we have to go, even a car will not. So the vehicle is not important in taking us to the goal. It's not a critical determinant of whether we'll reach our goal. Then what is it that determines whether we'll reach our goal? Not the vehicle, but the driver knowing where he has to go. And in the journey of life, the next question arises, what is the vehicle we have? In the journey of life, the vehicle we have is life itself, which means life itself gives us those opportunities which will take us towards the goal of life. Which means we should be able to use our life properly for going towards the goal. Now, this is an important question, or rather an important conclusion, because much of stress in life is because we are complaining and grumbling about the type of life we have. In other words, we are complaining and grumbling about the type of vehicle we have. And we saw that the vehicle is not really terribly important in determining where we have to go. So we are complaining about something relatively insignificant. If we know where we have to go, any type of vehicle, which means any type of life, will take us there. So instead of complaining about the type of life we have, it would be much better and more constructive if we start thinking how we can use the vehicle that we have for reaching our goal. That is what is more important. Now, as I said, I mean, your life will be spent, at least as a young doctor, mostly in your professional work. So your professional work then becomes the vehicle for going towards the goal of life. And that is how understanding the journey of life becomes relevant to your profession. But all the same, there are good vehicles and bad vehicles. There are vehicles which are faster and more comfortable and more sure to take us to the goal if we know where we have to go. Of course, that is basic. But, and there are vehicles which will take much longer and are not so comfortable. So how good a doctor's vehicle is for going towards the goal of life, that we shall come to in the end. In fact, again, it was a live audience. Towards the end of the session, I would have asked you to tell me how good is the doctor's vehicle for going towards the goal of life. So we leave it at this right now, and just keep in mind that the vehicle that we have in the journey of life is our life itself, and we should just try to see how we can use the vehicle that we have, that is the life we have, for going towards the goal of life. Now, in any journey, how do we get to that goal or the destination? The most important points in the journey are those where we have to make a choice. If you reach a crossroads or a T junction, you have to make up your mind whether to go straight, to turn right, or to turn left. And for making that type of a choice, we have a number of tools. In the olden days, we used maps and road signs. These days, it's much better to use the GPS because their guides are much better. What is the type of tool or tools that we have in the journey of life for going towards the goal of life? So the crucial point, crucial thing in going to the destination is making the right choice. And for that, we use certain tools. And in the journey of life, we use certain tools, and we'll see what those tools are. To understand these tools, I'll just give you an example. There are two ways, or at least two ways to practice medicine, or two contrasting ways to practice medicine, and everything between the two. So we'll talk about two contrasting ways in which one can practice medicine. Suppose a patient comes to you with headache. One way to handle this headache is to talk to this person nicely, have a genuine concern for this person, and have a sincere desire that you should be able to help this person come out of this problem of headache, which can be a serious problem when it is recurrent and chronic. And you think of your medical training, where you learned that the most common cause of a headache is stress. In fact, your teacher, Dr. Manasi Bhattacharya, worked on exactly this problem, and headache, or rather tension headaches. And she found that relaxation through yogic techniques was extremely useful. So you remember your medical training that the most common cause of a headache is stress, and therefore you spend half an hour talking to the person, just trying to go into his life enough to see where this person might be suffering. What is the underlying psychological distress for this physical symptom of a headache? And if you spend that half an hour, chances are that the person will open up, share the story of his life or her life with you, and you'll be able to address that, which will be going to the roots of the headache. This is one way to do it. What is the second way? The moment the person says headache, you write down a few investigations, including a CT scan of the skull. That will take you only 5 minutes. Well, you spend very little time with the patient and tell him that get these investigations done, and when you have all the reports, come to me after a week. I'm dramatizing a bit, but you can see the contrast. In one case, you just spent time with the patient, you went to the root of the problem, and probably succeeded in addressing it. In the second case, you spent very little time with the patient and ordered some investigations and sent him away, which does not really address the basic issue. Now, again, in a live audience, I would ask, which of these two ways you think is more commonly being practiced today? And the usual answer is the second way. It is somehow, all over. It's in the air. So we can all perceive that that is the way medicine is being practiced. And then if you are asked which is the better way, you would say the first way. So why is it that the first way, which is better, is not being used? Now, to understand this, let's see what are the tools that we are using to make this choice whether to see the patient the first way or the second way. One tool is the emotional part of the being, which is greedy and is looking for physical comforts, wants maximum comfort with minimum effort, and can see somehow that the first way is what will ensure that. The second tool that we have is our intellect, our capacity to reason. Now, one might use reason in many ways. One way to use reason would be that I studied in medical school that the commonest cause of a headache is stress, and the other common causes are high blood pressure and sinusitis. So apart from taking a detailed history so that I can discover if the person has some stress, at the most let me take also his blood pressure. Maybe it's the blood pressure which is responsible for his headache. Let me ask some history to find out whether the person has sinusitis. So you'll rule out the common causes of headache. And if I've ruled out the common causes, then that should be good enough. So this is the intellect working. Why? Because another thing that we learn in medicine is that first, try to go by the common causes, and if only you do not succeed, you should think of the rare causes. Now, there's also a second way to think about it. There are rare causes of headache, like a brain tumor. And how do I know that this person does not have a brain tumor? And therefore, a CT scan of the skull is very important. And these days, the patients are becoming so, you know, keen to go to the court. Suppose after 3 months, I get a CT scan done, and then a brain tumor is discovered. Then this person would turn around and say that I came to you 3 months ago. Why didn't you ask for a CT scan then? During these 3 months, my brain tumor has grown. At that time, it might have been operable and curable. Now it has become inoperable and incurable. And then I'll be charged with not practicing medicine properly. And that is why it is important that right at the first visit, I ask also for the CT scan. So you can, this is what is called defensive medicine, practicing defensive medicine. So you can justify the first way of handling the situation at the mental level, at the level of the intellect, by saying that one should rule out the common causes, spend some time being guided only by the common causes, and then only think of the rare ones. If we don't succeed, then you think of the rare causes. So the intellect can justify doing it the first way, spending more time and trying to just discover whether the person has one of those three basic causes, and if he has stress, then how to address that. The second way can also be justified because defensive medicine has become a reality today. Which means that reason, which we place on a very high pedestal, and it is very important, it is the best tool developed in human beings, and it is what is behind a lot of progress in science and technology. It becomes an insufficient tool for making choices in life. Now let us see what are the consequences of following one type of way of practicing medicine compared to the other. Suppose the person spends half an hour with this person, discovers the cause of stress, addresses that, and the patient recovers. How does this doctor feel? The doctor feels very good. He feels he gets immense joy, and he has lasting mental peace because he feels that intervened to the minimum possible extent. With minimum intervention, I have been able to solve this person's problem. On the other hand, if he practices medicine the second way, and he has justified it also, because defensive medicine is a reality today. So he has a full justification for it. But then still, how does he feel? He feels guilty. Probably I should not have made the patient spend so much money. Probably I should have spent some more time with him. So he feels guilty because he knows what the better thing to do is, somewhere deep within. And chances are that all these investigations will turn out to be negative. And if he continues by the current trend, then he will prescribe him some drugs. Drugs which will try to treat the headache directly. Maybe if he feels that the stress is responsible, maybe he will give a tranquilizer to the patient. And if he feels that even that is not working, then he'll refer him to a psychiatrist. Every time he'll spend not more than a few minutes with the person. And from everything that he does for the person, whether it is a consultation or whether it is an investigation or whether it is a referral, he might get a commission. That is also a known fact. Which means that he'll be making a lot of money, spending very little time with the patient. But then how does he feel at the end of it? He feels guilty all along. I have not done my best for the patient. And when he feels guilty, he doesn't stop there. It keeps haunting him because he's doing that type of practice with almost every patient who comes to him every day. So this guilt and this uneasiness becomes a constant companion, which means that the doctor is always under stress himself. Now, if the emotional part of his being is greedy, is looking for physical comfort, and the intellect has been able to justify the second approach by justifying defensive medicine, then which is this dissenting part of the being which is making him feel guilty and uneasy? This is yet a third part of the being, because the emotional part of the being and the intellect, that is his feelings and thinking, have come to some sort of an understanding with each other, what we call in Hindi, samjhota ho gaya unka. they have learned to compromise with, reached a compromise with each other and agreed to speak in the same voice. So the dissenting voice, which is making him feel guilty if he practices medicine the second way, is yet some third part of the being. And that is also a tool which is giving him a contrary guidance, different from the guidance coming from the feelings and the intellect. Now it is this third tool, which is our divine essence. That is the source of this inner voice, or the voice of the deepest self, or whatever you like to call it. So in the journey of life, the tools that we use in our use for making choices are our feelings, reason, which is what the intellect uses, and this inner voice, which is coming from our divine essence, sometimes called the soul. So while talking about these tools, what we have also ended up doing is answering one very basic question, and that is, who am I? What is the totality of a person? Who is a person? Who is an individual? An individual consists of the body and the mind. The mind has two aspects, feeling and thinking. The emotional part of the being and the intellect, they both constitute the mind. But then behind what we can easily identify with, that is the body and the mind, there is also a hidden entity, which is our divine essence, the soul. And the soul is not there just to give us the consolation that some bit of us will continue to live even after we are dead and gone. The soul is immortal. You know, that is something which we all sort of take it as axiomatic. So at least the soul will continue to live even after we are dead and gone. The soul is not there just to give us that consolation. The soul also has a dynamic aspect. The soul has a dynamic aspect which speaks to us off and on at opportune moments, at critical moments, and tells us what the right thing to do is. The soul is also a guide. This dynamic aspect of the soul, which is a guide, is what Sri Aurobindo and the mother have called the psychic being. So the psychic being is only an aspect of only the soul. So the soul and the psychic being are not fundamentally different. The psychic being is the dynamic part. The soul also has a static part, which is just a witness, which does not participate in day-to-day life. But the soul has a component, an aspect, which does participate in day-to-day life. And it is there from which we get the guidance, along with the guidance that we get from the emotional part of the being and the intellect. Now, if I were to ask you, if these are the tools that we have for making choices, feelings, reason, and the inner voice, which of these tools takes us towards the goal of life? Intuitively, you would feel that the direction in which I am trying to guide you is that it is the inner voice that actually takes us towards the goal, and you would be quite right. That is exactly where I am driving. And I also shown you that listening to this inner voice gives us joy and lasting mental peace, whereas neglecting it, ignoring it, can give us guilt and recurrent uneasiness. Now, if the inner voice is so important, then we should also know what are the characteristics of this inner voice, how we identify it, how would we understand it as something different from the voice of the emotional part of the being or the intellect. So let's go over the characteristics of the inner voice. It's a rather shy, faint, and non-assertive voice. You know, it does not insist. In contrast, the voice coming from the emotional part of the being and the intellect is very noisy. And those voices persist. They don't give up easily. Whereas this voice is non-assertive. Says jo marzi kar lo, you can do what you like. It puts in a whisper, a shy and faint whisper, and then disappears. Do what you like. Although it is shy, faint, and non-assertive, all the same, it is a very clear voice. And it's a very quick voice. It's very clear in the sense that it leaves us with no doubts and questions. The intellect, you know, because it can justify doing something, it can also justify not doing something. It's not a very clear voice. It's a vacillating voice. It takes a long time to arrive at a conclusion because it goes through a prolonged analysis of profit and loss, risk and benefit, and then tries to choose something which is least risky and most beneficial in terms of something concrete which can be measured, like say money. So that is the two way the reason works, and therefore it's a time consuming laborious process. And still, because it can justify everything, doing something and not doing something, it leaves us with some doubts and questions. This voice, unlike the voice of reason, is a very clear voice. It's also very quick, which means it doesn't take time. It doesn't take much time for it to give its verdict. In a flash, in a fraction of a second, as soon as the situation presents itself, we know what the right thing to do is. So it's a very quick voice. But all the same, it's a voice which may make us lose something, like say money. And therefore, we may not listen to it, we may ignore it because it is a non-assertive voice. How is it that we very often end up actually listening to this voice? We end up listening to this voice because it is not only a guide, it is also associated with a reward and punishment system. The reward of doing the right thing is joy and lasting mental peace. And the punishment for not doing the right thing, for not listening to this inner voice, for neglecting it, ignoring it, for violating it, the punishment is a sense of guilt and recurrent uneasiness. So it's because of this association with reward and punishment that we may end up listening to this voice. Now, the next question that arises is, which of these tools gives me the choices that will take me towards the destination of the journey called life? That question actually, in a way, was answered earlier also, that it is the inner voice that takes us towards that goal. But then you may say that my business, my life is my business. Who is anybody to tell me how I should live? Suppose my destination is to make a lot of money as much as possible, as quickly as possible, and live a physically comfortable life. Then what is the problem? You are probably talking about some other type of destination. I don't want that destination. And I can see, I look around, I find that the goal that I have, that is making as much money as possible, any which how, and being physically comfortable, is something which a lot of people around me are doing. That seems to be their goal of life, that is my goal of life, and they seem to be doing it. They seem to be reaching this goal of being rich and famous and powerful and comfortable. They are able to reach these types of goals by not listening to their inner voice. I can make out from their behavior, they never listen to the inner voice, and yet they're getting all these things. So then why should I care for all this? I'll also listen to the intellect which works on the basis of profit and loss, risk and benefit. So I'll also do what brings maximum benefit and at minimum risk, minimum loss, minimum concrete loss. So that is what I will also do. Now, that's a very valid question. But then that I'll answer in the next part of the session. So we have a brief interval. If any of you wants to ask any questions, you can ask that. Otherwise, we'll spend the time listening to some music.
Sir, I can play guitar.
Okay, you can play guitar? Okay, please play guitar for some 5 minutes or so. Sir, how long do you want?
Yeah, 5 minutes.
Yeah, 5 minutes, Nirnay. Please do that. Very nice of you.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Nirnay. Thank you, Nirna.
Lovely guitar recital to compensate for everything. Sare jahan se acha Hindustan hamara. Very good music and very nice choice. So with that interval, now we go back to the question that I had raised. After all, my life, my choice, if I choose to be rich and famous and powerful and comfortable, and I find that most people who are not listening to their inner voice are the ones who are getting all these things, what is the problem? So to answer that question, I'll go about in a little roundabout way. That for the next few minutes, just assume that you have made the choice based on the inner voice. What is it that you get from that choice? We saw that what we get from that choice is immense joy and lasting mental peace. What else do we get? You keep moving the slides.
Yes, sir.
The next one, you find that we escape guilt and recurrent uneasiness. And in the next one is control. What is this control? Control over our sense of well-being, control over our happiness. Now, what does it mean? What it means is that normally, you know, there are two types of happiness. One is the happiness based on getting something. Like say you get a new dress or you get admitted to a medical school. All these things make you happy. Basically, you get something. But you also feel happy when you give something. When you have a nice meal in a restaurant, you are happy. But suppose you feed a poor person, again, you are happy. So there's a happiness which comes from getting, and there's a happiness which comes from giving. If you just reflect, you'll find that the type of choices that you get from this inner voice involve giving, not getting. You give up the additional money that you can get by seeing the patient in a certain way. So that is also a type of giving. You are giving all of yourself to the patient, the best of yourself to the patient. That is a type of giving. So the choices that come from the inner voice involve giving. Now, giving is not generous. It places the control of happiness in your own hands, because giving is always in our own hands. Getting is not. So to get the happiness which comes from giving is always in our own hands. The happiness which comes from getting is not. And further, if you just try to reflect, what is it that makes you happier? Having a nice meal in a restaurant or feeding a poor person? You see that the two have a very different type of feel. Feeding a poor person has a superior feel. And that's why, you know, we say that the joy of giving is far better than the happiness of getting something. And these choices, by guiding you towards the joy of giving, place the handle of your happiness in your own hands, because giving is always in our own hands. Nobody can stop us from doing that. But getting is not always in our own hands. Nobody gets actually everything that the person wants. Next, please. The next is absence of conflict. Now, what does this mean? Absence of conflict between what? conflict between the emotional part of the being, the intellect and the soul, or this inner voice. We found that they can be often at conflict, but they don't always have to be at conflict. Why? Because every time we make a choice, we are generating an experience. An experience leads to learning. If we make a choice which is guided by the inner voice, we get an experience of joy and lasting mental peace. If we make a choice which is different, which violates this inner voice, we get an experience of guilt and recurrent uneasiness. Now, these experiences start training the emotional part of the being. And the emotional part of the being starts realizing that there's a certain type of choices, a certain category of choices which lead to joy and lasting mental peace. There's another type of choices which lead to guilt and recurrent uneasiness. And after all, what does the emotional part of the being want? It wants happiness. It wants to avoid guilt and recurrent uneasiness. So when it finds that there's a certain category of choices which gives what it wants, which avoids what it does not want, and it places the control for that happiness in its own hands, the emotional part of the being starts making the same type of choices as the soul. And when the two speak in the same voice, the intellect easily falls in line, because we have seen that the intellect is a very versatile tool. It can justify anything, and therefore it starts justifying the voice of the soul. The result is that there's an absence of conflict, because the soul is telling us to do something, the emotional part of the being is making the same choice, and the intellect has invented a reason to justify that choice. So when all three are saying the same thing, the body, the poor body, is a docile instrument that just falls in line and does what the mind tells it to do. So that is what we may call is the unification of the being, when there is no conflict between different parts of the being. Total absence of conflict all the time in every choice is a long journey. But the more often we make these choices, not only we get more of the things like joy and lasting mental peace, the more often we escape this guilt and recurrent uneasiness, we also gradually are contributing to this transformation, this change, this major change in the emotional part of the being and the intellect. In fact, the major hurdle is the emotional part of the being, because much though we may not like, we are guided primarily by the emotional part of the being. That is what rules us. If that has started behaving well, then the intellect finds reasons to support it, and the poor body just does what it is told to do. So the major problem is the emotional part of the being, and that gets trained through this type of experiences, because it wants joy, it wants lasting mental peace, it wants to escape recurrent uneasiness, and it wants control in its hands. So this is how this absence of conflict is reached. Now, just to make it clear, very often I raise a question at this point, that if there's a conflict between three persons, say for example, this can be conflict can be removed in two ways. One is that each of the three makes some sort of a compromise, makes a bit of a change so that they reach some sort of a consensus. So all three make some compromise. The second type of second way of removing the conflict is that two of these three accept that the third one is wise, always correct. They take that third one as the gold standard and agree to just do what this third party tells. So two have bent themselves to suit the third. Again, the conflict is removed. So which out of these two is the method being followed in reaching this absence of conflict in this situation? Is it a method of compromise, or is it a method of one of them being treated as the gold standard by the other two? Now you see clearly that here it is the second method, that is the emotional part of the being and the intellect have accepted this inner voice to be the gold standard with which they should agree. They have taken that as the reference standard, which is always correct. And that is how the conflict has been removed. Next slide, please. Now you'll see that all these things which we are talking about, coming from the inner voice of soul, are about being a good person. And that leads us to this basic question which Victor Hugo raised in one of his novels. Are we happy because we are good, or are we good because we are happy? You know, we sometimes think one way and sometimes the other. Are we happy because we are good? Means, does being good lead us lead to happiness? Or are we good because we are happy? Which means that we are happy with all the wealth and power and comforts that we have. So since that has made us happy, we can afford to be good. That is another way to look at it. In fact, the time-tested wisdom is that we are happy because we are good. So being good leads to happiness. And that is what we have seen in the previous slides, that if we are good, that gives us joy, lasting mental peace, avoids guilt and recurrent uneasiness, gives us control over our happiness, and leads to absence of conflict between different parts of the being, which means leads to harmony between different parts of the being. And all these things are a part of being happy. All these things together make us happy. All these things add up to good mental health. And when mental health is good, next slide please, our physical health also becomes good, because now the mind-body connection is on a very sound scientific footing. I'm sure one of these days your teachers will talk about a new discipline which is not very new anymore. It has been around for about 50 years now. This discipline is called psychoneuroimmunology, which means that the mind can work through the nervous system and the endocrine system to affect the immune system. When we are happy, our immune system is better. And immune system being better means protection from many diseases, including the coronavirus. And it also means good healing capacity, because the capacity to heal and the capacity to get protection from disease are closely linked and employs similar mechanisms. So that's how we get good health, if we are happy. So being good makes us happy, and being happy gives us good health. Next slide, please. Now, here is a well-known cardiologist, Dean Ornish, who is a pioneer in introducing a yogic intervention in the treatment of cardiac disease, yogic in a comprehensive sense, not just asanas and pranayamas. I'll not go into what that comprehensive thing is. But then what is this major conclusion which he has reached, which he has put it somewhere very emphatically? Not diet, not drugs, not exercise, not smoking, not surgery, not even genetics. No other factor has a more powerful effect on health and premature death and disease than love and intimacy. And you see that all the choices that we have been talking about coming from the soul are basically an expression of love. Only when you love somebody that you are willing to give something. So they are an expression of love. Giving is an expression of love. So one who practices love and intimacy becomes happy and also healthy. So all these physical factors like diet, drugs, exercise, smoking, etc., etc., which we normally associate with health, are important. They do contribute, but then none of them is as effective as love. We can't go into the details because this itself is a very interesting topic. And this is not just exaggeration. Next slide, please. It's not just exaggeration to say that love is so important. There is enough evidence from a variety of studies, experimental, epidemiological, and clinical, support this conclusion which Dean Ornish has reached. In fact, someplace he has said that if the drug industry were to discover something as potent as love, the side effects of which are only positive, it would be overnight hailed as a breakthrough. So now, are we on that slide which says fulfillment at the bottom? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Fulfillment, no?
Yeah.
Now, what else do we get from such choices? Fulfillment. Now, what is fulfillment? It's different from contentment and satisfaction. They are all along the same lines, But fulfillment goes beyond all of these, satisfaction, contentment, etc., etc. Fulfillment is the feeling that now I want nothing else because I have everything. Now, this is an ultimate type of a feeling. And when do we get that? If a young person like you, medical students, was asked, what is it that if you have, after that you'll say that now I don't need anything else because I have everything. It will be quite natural for you to say that if I'm in good health, if I have a degree, if I have a successful medical practice, and if I get married to a nice person, my children are doing well, and I have all the physical comforts in life, and I have good harmonious relationship with my family, and I have mental satisfaction, intellectual satisfaction in my work, what else will I need? I'll be fulfilled. In other words, you are thinking in terms of the satisfaction of the body, the emotional part of the being, and the intellect. The body should be comfortable. Emotionally, I should be happy because I have comforts and my relationships are harmonious. And the intellect, I have intellectual satisfaction from my work. But how about the soul? That has not been addressed, and therefore the fulfillment does not come. I'm not saying that you should not pursue all these things, because you will not realize it till you have at least some of those things which you think you should have, and they are very legitimate desires and ambitions. So get them, but then if you get disappointed and you do not get that sense of fulfillment after having all those things, don't be surprised, because this is what has happened to many people. Next slide, please. Now in the next slide, you see a picture of a man whose name is Mani Bhaumik. Mani Bhaumik is a person who was born sometime in the 1940s in a rather poor family. He had a difficult childhood, but was very intelligent, managed to get a PhD from one of the IITs, PhD in physics, went for a postdoctoral fellowship to the US. And there he got engaged in research in some field associated with laser. And then laser, as you know, came to have many applications, including applications in medicine. So that brought him a lot of royalties. So he became a very rich man. He also became a famous man, a powerful man, a well-decorated man with plenty of awards and prizes. And he used that wealth to buy lots of houses. This building that you see in the picture is just one out of his several houses in California. He started holding parties. And as he says that in the process, he forgot his science, because now he need not practice any science. He also forgot his spiritual roots in India. And he was either attending parties or holding parties. After one such party at his house, after the guests had left, and he was roaming around in the living room all alone, he spotted a visiting card. He picked it up. It had the name of a celebrity. And he said to himself, is this what life is all about? And then threw the visiting card. So just picking up this visiting card and raising this question somewhere inside, is this what life is all about, was a turning point. After that, he gave a new direction to his life. Next slide, please. Next picture. And he went on to write a book called Codenamed God. And in that, at one place, he says, while talking about this incident, how he got this awakening, one hears often of spiritual birth arising from despair and destitution, which means one is going through a difficult phase in life, one gets a spiritual awakening, which is very true. That happens quite a lot. But then this spiritual rebirth or awakening can also be prompted by an absence of want, when apparently you don't want anything more. That can also give rise to the same, a queasy feeling, an uneasy feeling, a very strange type of a feeling of being overfed and undernourished at the same time. Overfed with material comfort and all other material benefits, and undernourished spiritually. The body, mind, and the intellect are overfed. The soul is neglected, undernourished. That's what creates this uneasy feeling. So here is a man who got more than what any one of us could perhaps wish or imagine. He had all the money that anybody can want. all the physical comforts, name, fame, power, prestige, connections, and plenty of intellectual satisfaction from his works, one award after another. And yet, one day, he reached the conclusion, there's something missing in life. Some part of me feels undernourished, and that created this uneasy feeling. So not to get this uneasy feeling, there is no other way but to address the needs of the soul. In other words, make the right choices in life. That is what basically it comes to. At least that one of the major ways in which this need can be satisfied. So that is fulfillment. So what do I get from the choices which I make at the level of the soul? Immense joy, lasting mental peace. Next slide, please. Escaping guilt and recurrent uneasiness, control over my happiness, absence of conflict, good health, fulfillment. Next, please. In short, these choices give me just about everything that I am looking for, or for that matter, anybody is looking for. So if by making a certain type of choices, I get everything that I am looking for, what is the problem in making those type of choices? And that probably answers the question, my life, my business, I can choose my goals and make the choices I want. Yes, of course, we have that right. But that will not give you all these things, and that will not give you fulfillment. And it is because people are looking for those things at the wrong place that so many people in the world are disappointed and are not getting those things. They keep getting disappointed repeatedly, but yet can't they put their finger at the right place. And that is why they keep getting disappointed and disillusioned repeatedly. Next, please. So if one were to put it diagrammatically, you got that diagram now, no? In which you have a person in a vehicle.
Yes, sir.
Right? Yes. So there's a person in a vehicle, vehicle called life, and he has reached a point where he has a choice to make. The emotions are guiding him in one direction, the intellect in another, and the soul is another. And what will take him towards the goal is the choice given by the soul. If he makes a choice, he takes a few steps towards the goal. If he makes a different choice, for example, he chooses the choice of the intellect, then he goes in the wrong direction. But that doesn't mean all is lost. No, on the road also, if you make a wrong choice, suppose you had to go straight, but instead you are compelled to turn left because of a traffic jam. It's not that you'll never reach your goal. You can reach your destination still by taking a little longer and more zigzag route. And that is what happens in life also. But then another thing that you can see in this diagram is that depending upon the choice that the person makes, the person gets different type of scenery. Now, the scenery in the journey of life corresponds to the type of conditions and circumstances we get in life. And the conditions and circumstances we get in life is what we call destiny. In other words, through the choices that we make, we are rewriting our destiny all the time. The third thing that you see in this diagram is those dotted lines connecting the emotions and the soul, the intellect and the soul. What are those dotted lines? Those dotted lines indicate the transformation of the emotional part of the being and the intellect. You know, the roads on the real roads on the real roads on which we travel in a car don't bend like this. But the emotions and the intellect are not rigid. They're capable of changing. They're capable of transformation. And as they transform, if we are sensitive to the type of experiences we are getting from different types of choices, gradually, the choices made by the emotions and the intellect start converging with the choices made by the soul. So as this convergence happens, we start making more easily the choices dictated by the soul. Next, please. Having a goal, of course, is the most important thing in life, no matter what that goal is. And the goal can keep changing throughout life. But a goal is important because, as the mother has said, an aimless life is always a miserable life. But there are different types of aims. On the quality of your aim will depend the quality of your life. What is a high quality aim? A high quality aim is high and wide, generous and disinterested. This is what will make your life precious to yourself and to others. So the type of aim that we have been talking about, the type of aim towards which the soul will guide us is high and wide, generous and disinterested. Disinterested doesn't mean that you lose interest in your work. Disinterested means that you will not be working out of a sense of self-interest. You will not be thinking only of what concrete things I will get as a result of this. So your aim is not to just take care of your own material interests, which can be calculated and measured, because you see, a degree is very concrete. Money is something which can be measured. The bank balance shows up in figures. But joy, lasting mental peace, they don't show up anywhere. You can't say 5 kilos of joy and 10 kilos of mental peace. So those things are intangible. It's only for tangible things that you lose interest, which means that you are not primarily being guided by that, and that is being disinterested. Your goal is disinterested. Next, please. So another interval. If there are any questions. Any questions from anybody? Want to play the guitar again, or somebody will sing?
There is a question in the chat box. I'll just read it out.
Sure.
Ayushman Tripathi has asked, can we truly call any choice good or bad between souls, intellects, and emotions?
Yes, that decision or that label is quite clear. The choice made by the soul is good. The choices which come in conflict with it are bad. I'm careful in saying that choices which come in conflict with it, because the choices made by the emotional part of the being and the intellect don't necessarily have to come in conflict with it. It's something like this, you see. There are tools at different levels. At the lowest level are the emotions. Emotions are at the lowest level because they are behind the best that man can do. They are also behind the worst that man can do. They bring out the best and the worst of man, and they are very powerful and compelling in character. If you think of the heroic deeds that a person does, like say climbing the Everest, that is because of emotions. If a person gives up all his life savings in charity, that is again an emotional decision. These are some of the great things that a person can do as a result under the spell of emotions. But then all the rapes and murders and financial scams are also the result of the emotions overpowering a person. So the emotions can work both for good and bad, but they're very powerful. The next higher tool is reason, because reason can save us from some of the ill effects of emotions, because if for nothing else, we'll feel that if I get involved in a rape or a murder or a financial scam, I may be caught and then my life may be ruined. So at least that fear is there, fear of the risk of being caught and found out. So, and there is also certain type of rationalistic ethics, which tells me what is good and bad on the basis of reason. So reason can theoretically protect us from the ill effects of emotions, the bad choices given by emotions. But reason is not able to play that legitimate role because it can get overpowered by emotions. And as we saw, the emotions can compel the intellect to invent a reason to justify what the emotions want, including the bad choices which emotions have made. The soul cannot be influenced by anything. It always gives the best choice. It always gives the right choice and gives it very quickly and clearly. The emotions, you see, emotions are the level of the reason and the soul, but they can rise to the level of the soul. They are capable of lifting themselves up to that level, and that is why they can appreciate the joy which comes from the choice of the soul. The intellect may also be below the level of the soul, but it can lift itself up to the level of the soul, and that's why it can give us reasons for the choice of the soul. So the right kind of choice comes from the soul, but the emotions, the intellect are capable of moving towards the perfection of the soul and giving the same choice. And it is this type of a change in the emotional part of the being and the intellect which we are working at when we are living a good life. So when we live a good life, we are trying to change our surface instrument, that is the feelings and the intellect, so that they rise to that level. So using Sri Aurobindo's terminology, you know, emotions are infrarational, that is, they're below the level of reason. The soul is suprarational, it is higher than the level of reason. Reason is an intermediate tool. So the emotions can lift themselves up to the suprarational level, and their infrarational level can become more and more indistinct and inoperative, which means the person no longer gets tempted by evil things. He enjoys only good things. So that is the emotions lifting themselves up to a higher level. And when that happens, reason also lifts itself up to a higher level, and that also starts giving more and more justification for the right thing. So that's why when you say that will the choice given by the soul will be good and the others will be bad, that is not right. The choice given by the soul will be the best always. The choices which come in conflict with it will not be good. But the choice of the emotions and intellect may not be in conflict. And it is because the emotions do not depend upon reason, they are also non-rational. So the soul is non-rational, the emotions are also non-rational. Because both are non-rational, when we make a choice at the level of the soul, very often we feel it came from my heart. Heart can mean the emotions, heart can mean the soul. Because we can't distinguish between the two. It just made us feel good. I thought that was the best thing to do. I knew that this is what is going to make me truly happy. Now, which means that we are mixing up the voice of the emotions and the soul. And the mix-up is very easy because both are non-rational. The justification from the rational part of the being came later on to justify it. But both being non-rational, when the emotions lifted themselves up to the level of the soul and made a certain choice, which was the same as that of the soul, we can't even make out whether it came from the emotional part of the being or from the soul. We just say it came from the heart. Okay? Does that clarify? Make that answer your question?
Yes, sir. Ayushman has said, thank you, sir. What practices we must incorporate in life so we can listen to our soul in today's world where we have a large spectrum of morality of good or bad?
Yes, practices are always secondary. Practices are a facilitator. Ultimately, the choice has to be made by us, which means we have to learn to identify this inner voice. For identification of the inner voice, in contrast with the voice which comes in conflict with it, we have to ask ourselves sincerely one basic question. And the question is, will this choice leave me in lasting mental peace? Lasting mental peace is a crucial thing. Because if we are making a choice which is in conflict with the voice of the soul might have died away because it's a non-assertive voice. The emotions and the intellect have joined each other to make a different type of choice. And at that time, we feel very strongly this is the only right thing to do. And it is in violation of the voice of the soul, because the voice of the soul is no longer speaking. It has gone to sleep. When we make that type of a choice, we feel very justified in doing it. But if we go within and once again ask ourselves, will this choice leave me in lasting mental peace? Somewhere deep within, we know right now I have found all the reasons for doing it, but sooner or later it will catch up with me and then I'll feel bad. You know, we had an ENT professor who used to talk about one of his ENT colleagues in private practice. And he said that when this colleague of mine in private practice was on his deathbed, he was very worried. And the reason for the worry was, he said, when I die and go up there and I'm asked, why you removed all those tonsils unnecessarily, what will I reply? Which means that all his life he had somehow justified removing all those tonsils. But somewhere deep within knew that all those tonsillectomies were not justified. They were not necessary. And now at his deathbed, it had caught up with him and he was feeling uneasy. Which means He had been at peace all his life because somehow he had been a busy practitioner and engaged in all the daily humdrum of life, no time to think about what makes me easy and uneasy and what gives me joy and what gives me lasting mental peace. He had no time for any of these things. But when he was dying, it caught up with him. So basic question to ask ourselves is, will this choice leave me in lasting mental peace? So introspection, which means preferably before making the choice and acting upon it. Even if you make a mistake after that, if you introspect, even that is good. Because at least it tells, well, this time I made a mistake. I made a choice which is not leaving me in lasting mental peace. Next time I'll do better. So, you know, that is how we progress. It's not a one-time event of this. Total absence of conflict is not a one-time event. It's a long journey. But introspection is the most important practice. And that introspection, the best time to do it is in silence, when you are to yourself. And that is one way of looking at meditation. So, you know, when people say that meditation helps in living this type of a life, they are sometimes emphasizing the technique, forgetting that it is not the technique which will do it. It is the process underlying the technique which can do it, which means unless you fill that technique with the right process, with the right aims, with the right goals, just sitting quietly, following very meticulously to the letter one type of technique or the other in meditation is not what is going to help. It will neither give us peace of mind, which you are looking for, that is some sort of stress relief for which people often meditate, nor will it lead to this type of progress. So meditation is a good time for this introspection. And even if you don't regularly meditate, early in the morning when you get up, you pray, that time you can introspect. In the evening, you can meditate while going to bed. Think of how the day was spent, which choices were made at the right level, which choices were not made properly, which are the choices which will leave me in lasting mental peace, which are the choices which will not leave me in lasting mental peace. So all that can be done at bedtime. So it's not that formal meditation is important, it's the process which is important.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Sir, there are a few more questions. Before starting the session, should we take them?
I mean, I am not very short of time, so I can
right,
do even
sir.
Now.
No, even, yes, sir. Sir, similar kind of question. I think it has kind of been answered, but if you would like to add, Nirnay Sharma has asked, how do we know a choice is good without the benefit of hindsight?
If we ask the same question before actually acting upon the choice, that will be without hindsight. But then, you know, the journey from discovering the mistake in hindsight and avoiding the mistake altogether so that it is not in hindsight, there's a big gap between the two. That itself is a long journey. Very often, at the beginning of the journey, you will make mistakes and then discover it only later. So you don't have to be too harsh with yourself, too critical of yourself. That happens to everybody. Okay.
There's another question by Raghav. Sir, can you give an example of a decision made by soul?
One example I gave you of seeing a patient properly. Another quick example, suppose there's a building on fire. And a fireman has reached there and he's told that there are a few people trapped inside the building. So his first impulse is, let me enter the building and bring these people out. Then his next thought is, very hot and suffocating inside the building. Then the next thought is, it will be very risky. Suppose we die, what will happen to my family? Now here again, you find three different voices speaking. It will be very hot and suffocating. That is the voice of the emotional part of the being. It will be risky. If I die, what will happen to my family? That is the voice of the intellect. The first impulse that he got, let me enter the building and rescue these people, that was the voice of the soul. And again, the same consequences. If he enters the building, irrespective of the consequences, whether he's able to rescue or not rescue anybody, he gets joy and lasting mental peace. I did my best. Suppose he doesn't enter, especially if later on it is found a few people died, he feels guilty and gets recurrent uneasiness. Okay.
Another question Rishabh Komal has asked. This also sir has answered to some extent. Sir, does a bad choice always remain bad? Can't it be changed to the best choice by one's own effort?
So the choice cannot be changed because the past is something which nobody can change. What can change is that it can act as a trigger for becoming a better person. You might have heard of those extreme examples in some mythological tales of a dacoit turning into a rishi. You know, that's the story of Valmiki. So great miraculous transformations can also take place, but that doesn't mean that what Valmiki did before he became a rishi, he has been able to undo. And in that sense, there is nothing which is really matters in the larger picture of the universe. What matters is the individual's rise or fall in consciousness. So sometimes one single event and one single stroke can reverse both that fall that had taken place in the past, fall in consciousness, and take it to a new height. That is what these examples illustrate. And the destiny is sort of changed 180 degrees. That's what changes the destiny 180 degrees. Said we are rewriting our destiny all the time. So there are some minor choices which make us take either one step forward or one step backwards. And there are some major choices which make us either fall in a ditch from where it's very difficult to come out, or they take us to a height which normally may take decades to climb. So some major leaps as well as major falls are there, and one step forward, one step backward, that is also there. So it depends upon what type of choice it is. But a choice made in the past in itself cannot be changed, because nobody can change the past.
Thank you, sir. Ritu Lak sir has two questions. One is, sir, how can something non-physical like soul affect our physical body? And the second one is, sir, is soul a belief or a science?
This question to answer properly will take much longer, so I'll not go into the details. But just to sort of come to something which is in between the soul and the physical body. In the physical body itself, if you try to think a little more clearly, when we talk of physiological mechanisms like say coagulation or the mechanisms of the immune system or so many mechanisms, we talk in terms of this particular interaction leads to this particular interaction, this one leads to this, and then this happens in this type of cell, and this type of cell has this type of receptors or this type of things, and that's why it leads to. What we are basically talking about is that basically either a difference in the electrical charge or some configuration on the surface leads to a cascade of reactions or a certain sequence of events at a molecular level, at a very micro level. Firstly, I mean, to have that sort of an engineering at micro level is itself a marvel of engineering. Secondly, all that is only part of the story, because it only tells us what happens. It still doesn't tell us why it happens. As if, you know, there's some sort of a thing which is a type of intelligence, which we don't call intelligence, which is packed into the body's molecules and cells, which is guiding them towards what to do next. And that intelligence is not a physical entity. That is why a molecule of adrenaline is in a test tube is not the same as a molecule of adrenaline in the body. Because the molecule of adrenaline in the body seems to know where my receptors are, where I have to act, to what extent, and so on and so forth. The one in the test tube does not know. The test tube, it's more of a physical entity or a chemical. In the body, it is charged with a certain intelligence. Now, that intelligence is what we call in spirituality the life force. The life force is, that's the difference between a living thing and a non-living thing. That life force is giving a certain amount of intelligence, which we don't normally consider intelligence. Intelligence is not only doing maths or doing research in a lab. This is also infinite intelligence. It's a infinite, it's a very marvelous expression of that infinite intelligence, but we don't call it intelligence. So that intelligence, which is fact, is also not a physical entity, which means that intelligence is not necessarily associated with a physical entity. The soul is not physical, and yet it can be remarkably intelligent. So, you know, that is one indirect way in which I'm trying to tell you. But what actually the soul is, how it got in there, and so on, that is a question which needs much longer answer. At the end, I'll show you a book which can give you all those answers. But, or if you want to talk, then one more session like this. In today's session, that we can't go into. Okay.
There is another concern raised by Ishita Agarwal. She says, "Sir, I am still not satisfied with how much this struggle or sacrifices will be better when I compare with people who are totally not practicing anything good and still enjoying everything in this physical world and seem more happy, apparently."
Yeah, that is something I mentioned already, that you may find that people who are not listening to the voice of the soul are getting the usual things which we look for, like money and power and prestige and promotions and everything, you know, they are getting. So it is natural to feel so. And that is why it is said that values actually don't work in a vacuum. Our environment makes a lot of difference. And unfortunately, the environment today is not very good, not conducive to encourage us towards in this direction. But there are some truths which never really change. And for that, you only have to scratch behind the surface. People who are getting all these things and seem apparently happy, just scratch them a bit below their surface. And you'll find that they're not as happy and healthy as they seem. The people who are violating this voice all the time in an unscrupulous manner are the people who are on tranquilizers. They are the people who are on sleeping pills. They are the people who are getting midlife diseases like heart disease and diabetes and cancer before they are 50-year-old. These are the people who are getting all this. And a lot of money that they have made in this way, they are paying back to doctors and hospitals, but are not able to get their health back. Because as you know, said in a very dramatic way, you might have heard it somewhere, that money can buy you a good bed, it can't buy you sleep. Money can buy you a good doctor, but money can't buy you health. So right now, I think that answer should help a bit. But as I said, I mean, I'm not saying that you should not pursue any of those things. Till you've got some of those things, you will not understand it. It will remain theory for you, but in moderation. You know, the ancient Indian ideal was not that you should not pursue these things. You should pursue them, but within the framework of right and wrong. The ancient Indian ideal was not for everybody to go away to a mountain or a cave. That was not the ancient Indian ideal. We have had a very vibrant and active life. And within that life, we brought in the sense of right and wrong. That is what the ancient Indian culture was about.
Okay. We'll take one last question and we can continue. One of our students, Tinku Singh, has asked, sir, what is the worst mistake one can make in his lifetime? Also, he asks, where does life end? And in future, if the unit of life is discovered, what would that be? Many questions.
Many questions in one. Yes, so the one question was,
what is the worst mistake one can make in his life?
Worst mistake one can make? Something which is, as I said, falling in the pit. One of those relatively irreversible steps which are in total violation of the voice of the soul, totally irreversible, and which would do harm to somebody. You know, there are many of these choices which don't do much harm to others. They harm basically us. Those are the least harmful. Those which harm others, the more severe the harm inflicted, the larger the number of people who are affected by it, the worse it is. So that would be one way of looking at which is the worst mistake one can make. And the second question is, when does life end?
Where does life end?
Where does life end? To that, there can be two questions, two answers. The common sense answer, and which is beyond controversy, is that it ends with death. But the spiritual answer, which is in keeping with the Vedantic truths, and this is not a theory but experienced by people, is that death is only a passage from one life to the other, which means that the journey of the soul is long. It continues from life to life, and rebirth, which means, in other words, rebirth. So death is not the end. Death is only one of the stations in a long journey. But then, instead of getting into the controversy whether rebirth exists or not, what is important to understand is that whether you believe in rebirth or you do not believe in rebirth, what matters right now to us is the life between which we have between birth and death in this life. So what we do in this life is what is of practical importance. The rest is relatively academic or theory. So instead of getting into a controversy which is for all practical purposes theoretical, better is to concentrate on this life.
Thank you, sir. I think we can continue with the session. In the end, we can again take up questions.
So next slide, please, after the interval. You might have noticed that all along I was saying that this is the choice that will take us towards the goal of life. I never said that it will make us reach the goal of life. Why? Because the goal of life, it remains a remote and theoretical point for most of us. But what is that goal? One way of looking at the goal is that it is a total transformation, which means that a total transformation of the emotional part of the being and the intellect, so that they always effortlessly, constantly give the same choice as the soul, which means there is a total and perfect and constant unification of the being. You can organize all your life around this unified being, the emotional part of the being, the intellect and the soul, and the body being a docile instrument also becomes a part of this unit. So the total person behaves as one unit. So this is one way of looking at the goal. Next slide, please. And this is what we call union of the body, mind and spirit. The spirit is more or less the same as the soul. What the difference is, again, we will not go into. But the reason I have used the word spirit here is because that is a very common glib phrase these days. Union of body, mind and spirit. And now you can understand what we transform, what that change is which brings about this union. The mind undergoes a transformation, that is both the emotional part of the being and the intellect, which together constitute the mind, they undergo a transformation so that they become one with the soul or the spirit. And then the body follows what the mind says, and the result is that there's a union, and this union is constant all the time. So this is another way of looking at it. But then once you understood the process and seen that it is a long journey, and reaching that end is for most of us a remote theoretical point, we'll probably not reach there in this life. If we understand that, then you'll know that if you are promised union of body, mind and spirit in a weekend workshop, it will not happen. You'll come back feeling, oh, bada maza aaya, bahut acha laga, achhi achhi baatein sunke aa gaye, ab hame pata hai life kaise jeeni hai. But you'll not reach union of body, mind and spirit over a weekend by attending a workshop. So those are exaggerated, extremely hyper exaggerated claims, just marketing strategies. They are not telling you what actually union of body, mind and spirit is. Okay. Next slide, please. So if the goal of life remains a remote theoretical point, what is the point in getting onto the journey? The point in getting onto the journey and still making some progress on that journey is that it gives us at least some bit of everything that we are looking for, and we have seen all those things which we get from those choices. But then instead of talking about the goal, why not talk about the purpose of life? The purpose of life is not a fixed point. The goal is a fixed point. The purpose is direction oriented. So goal is a destination, a fixed point. purpose is direction oriented, which means any movement towards that goal is fulfilling the purpose of life. So through every choice that we are making, either we are fulfilling the purpose of life or taking one step backwards on this journey. But the purpose of life, everybody can fulfill. Goal of life, most of us will not be able to reach in this life. Because from wherever we are, we can always take a few steps towards the goal. And the more we conscious we are of the process, the more steps we will take. Which means the nearer the goal we will be. And perchance, we may actually reach the goal. That also is possible. But then by being anxious about the goal, we will not get there any faster. You know, as Kabir has said in one of his couplets, that you can't make a plant grow faster by giving it too much water. It is programmed in a certain way. It will take its time. So spiritual progress also takes its time. You can accelerate it a bit. It's not as fixed as the growth of a plant, but all the same, it will take time. So by being impatient, you know, putting too much water on the plant, giving it the plant too much water is a sign of impatience. Impatience will not help. Impatience will not help here too. Here also getting impatient will not bring the goal any nearer. But the purpose of life everybody can fulfill. We can always take a few steps towards the goal. We can take a few steps in the right direction, and that is the purpose. Next, please. So now comes this picture again. So now you can see that how many steps we take towards the goal depends upon, firstly, the type of choices we make. Secondly, it also depends upon how many wrong choices and right choices we make. Because wrong choices make the path longer and more zigzag. And also there are certain choices which lead to a big leap or a big fall, certain choices which make a relatively small change. Since the time is running out, I'll not give an example to show how sometimes one small step can lead to a big leap. But at the end, if there will be some time, then you can remind me. I'll tell you, give you one example of that also. Okay. Next slide, please. So the question then arises, how can the purpose of life be fulfilled? Again, I'll give you only an incomplete answer today because, again, of shortage of time. But I'll stick to basically what we have talked because that's what is will give you a sense of continuity, and that is what one of the most practical things to do is for fulfilling the purpose of life. There are other things, but this remains one of the central issues. So how can the purpose of life be fulfilled? By making the right choices. Next, please. And what is common to all the right choices? The common to all the right choices is giving or love. Next slide, please. So the common factor is love. Next, please. You know, it's very easy to say that I love everybody. What is difficult is to love a few real people. Because when you have to love a few real people, you have to express that love. If you say I love everybody, you don't have to do anything to actually express your love to everybody. You can't go around all over the world and giving something to 12 billion people. You can't do that. So when it comes to helping or loving a few real people, love needs an expression. And what is the expression? The expression is giving. Now, giving requires a complementary situation. One can give only one what one has to someone who needs it. Both are important. You can't give what you don't have. That, of course, is easy to understand. But the second part is sometimes not realized. You cannot give it to someone who does not need it. For example, suppose you decide to express your love to blind people by helping them cross the road. You find a blind person on the road, then you tell that person, come, I'll help you cross the road. And the blind person says, thank you, but I am not interested in crossing the road right now. What will you do? You can't do anything for that person. Which means that you can give only to someone who needs it. Now keep this in mind, you can express your love only by giving what you have to someone who needs it. And that helps us fulfill the purpose of life, because basically all those choices which come from the soul are an expression of love and involve giving. So now this leads to this question which you can think about. What is the type of vehicle which would be a good vehicle for fulfilling the purpose of life? Theoretically, any type of life can be good enough because life is after all only a vehicle. If we know where we have to go, any vehicle will take us there or any life will take us there. But still there are good and bad vehicles. So what is it that will make a vehicle good? And if that is the criterion for the vehicle being good, is the doctor's vehicle good for fulfilling the purpose of life? So these are questions again in a live audience. I would spend considerable time on trying to get the responses from the students. But we are in a different type of setting. So I'll just give you a little pause to think and then see how far it matches the answer that I give you. After following a short chain of logic, the conclusion we reached was that fulfilling the purpose of life depends upon giving what we have to those who need it. So a good vehicle will be that which enables you to give what you have to those who need it. The greater the opportunity for giving what you have to those who need it, the better is the vehicle. So that is the criterion. Now, using that criterion, a doctor's vehicle is an excellent vehicle for fulfilling the purpose of life. Because you have the knowledge and the intentions and the capacity to help a person who is not well, to heal a person. And Mark, I mean, I didn't say just you have the knowledge, because knowledge alone is not enough. You also have the intentions, the sincerity, the empathy for the patient. All these things are something that you have. And the patient needs all these things. Without these things, the healing will not be complete. Your knowledge alone will not be enough. But that complementary situation where you can give what you have to those who need it exists for the doctor or the nurse in any caring profession for that matter, without making any effort. You don't have to make any effort to find those people who need what you have to give them. They come to you one after another. And incidentally, from that you also make a living. This combination in which an opportunity for fulfilling the purpose of life is coupled with making a living is not available to everybody. And that is why a doctor's vehicle is an excellent vehicle. So is the vehicle of a nurse or a teacher. The teacher, you know, gets students one after another, and the students need what the teacher has to give. What are the two things basically which the teacher has available to give? Knowledge and love. The student needs both these. And similarly, the doctor, he has what the patient needs. So without making any effort, the doctor gets patients one after another who need what he has to give. And since that complementary situation, that fit is available, this vehicle becomes an excellent vehicle. You might say that everybody gives something to somebody. Yes, and that is why, since everybody gives something to everybody, everybody can fulfill the purpose of life. Parents, for example, they give so much to their children. So the children need what a parent can give, and therefore that helps the parent fulfill the purpose of his or her life. But there is a difference. It is very easy to give to the child, to your own child. It is not so easy to give those who are not related to us by blood or marriage. The patients are not related to the doctor by blood or marriage. And still the doctor gives what the patients need, which makes it spiritually more significant. Because the relationship, the superficial relationships based on blood and marriage are the easier way to give. They make it easier to give, but then that love becomes conditional. It's based on a certain type of a relationship which is not the deepest spiritual relationship. Spiritually, we are related to everybody. We are all one. We have a connection with each other. We are all interrelated. And by giving an expression to that interrelatedness with everybody, the doctor has a vehicle which is a better opportunity to give than any parent has in the form of giving to the children. So a doctor's vehicle is an excellent vehicle for fulfilling the purpose of life, because this opportunity to give is built into the doctor's job. Next, please. This is a sentence that, or a line which comes towards the end of Savitri, which is a major work of Sri Aurobindo, an epic of 24,000 lines. This line is on the last page. To feel love
and one.
Next slide, yes. Sorry, I forgot to say that. So in the next slide, you see this. To feel love and oneness is to live. Which means that to live, which means the purpose of life, is fulfilled only if we live a life which is inspired by oneness. This oneness will lead to love, because you know, love needs a feeling of oneness. Who are the people whom you love, with whom you feel some connection, with whom you feel one, with whom you feel related, who have some similarity with you, because of which you may feel one with them? People having similar ideas, similar speaking similar language, etc., etc. So you know, some similarity makes you feel one with them, and this oneness inspires love. But then there are certain deeper level at which we are all one, all interrelated. To get that feeling, to be inspired by it, feeling that love for everybody will lead to an expression of love to those who are around you, and that is the way to live. That is what fulfills the purpose of life. That is what makes life meaningful. Next, please. Now, this is the book which will give an answer to that type of question which was asked. What is the soul? How did it get in? And so on and so forth. This book gives you that, plus what we talked today, plus a lot more. Medical students might be familiar with understanding physiology. Sorry, understanding medical physiology. This is another type of book, starting with title starts with understanding spirituality and living it 24/7. And the subtitle is Real Questions, Rational Answers. You will not easily get it in bookshops, because we don't have a good system of distribution. It has been published by the ashram, but young people who want to an e-book instead of a hard copy, we'll find it on Amazon. If you go to Amazon, you can get an e-copy easily, e-book. And if you want a hard copy, then you can send an email to me. I'll forward it to our bookshop. They can courier the book to you. I can't really think of many other ways in which you can get the book sitting in Guwahati. Here's another beautiful book which some of you may want to read, by Dean Ornish, the cardiologist whom I mentioned during the talk. Dr. Dean Ornish's Program for Reversing Heart Disease. This is a classic. It's a paperback. It's for the general public, but equally good for doctors. And it's a well-referenced paperback, which means that for most of the major statements made in the book, although the style is popular and conversational, for most of the statements made in the book, there's also a reference given. And a similar referenced paperback is by Bernie Siegel, a cancer surgeon, an American cancer surgeon, Love, Medicine and Miracles. Another book by Bernie Siegel is Peace, Love and Healing. All these books that Bernie Siegel has written try to bring out the mind-body relationship in cancer. And whether it is Dean Ornish or whether it is Bernie Siegel or whether it is many more like them, who are the pioneers in mind-body medicine today, they all have basically benefited a lot and turned in this direction, while turning in this direction, made a lot of use of ancient Indian wisdom. A glimpse of that ancient Indian wisdom I have tried to give you today. But since our tendency is to appreciate what the people in the West appreciate, I'm just trying to show you that these are doctors in the West who have taken deep interest in ancient Indian wisdom after doing courses in modern medicine, practicing modern medicine from some of the best medical schools in the world. and still found that ancient Indian wisdom has given them something which is of great value in their practice and which has opened up new doors for healing, which is impossible, a level of healing which is impossible purely through the mechanical and sort of drug and surgery and physical measure based medicine, which we feel is scientific, and the rest is all rubbish. The rest is not rubbish, the rest is sometimes more important. As Einstein said, you know, that everything that counts cannot be counted. Just because evidence based medicine can be published in several papers doesn't mean providence based medicine does not exist. This is the place where I live and work, and hopefully the travel conditions will improve and some of you will be able to make a visit to Delhi and see this place and maybe even stay in the place for a few days. If you have any questions or comments, please feel free to contact me. The email address is simple: rm for Ramesh, bij for Bijlani, rambij@gmail.com. Thank you. Sorry, I went on changing the slides, but didn't say so. You might have done it on your own, isn't it? Hello?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yeah.
So you reached the last slide, no?
No. Yes.
Sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for accepting to conduct this session. We'll just continue with a few more words, but I would just like to say that you have, sir, has so nicely explained the position of the doctor. Like these very young students, they may not be able to, you know, think so much about the soul and all these things, but making the right choices is so important in life. And being a doctor is a blessed thing to happen in their life, because they can actually carry on the purpose of life by pursuing this profession. Thank you so much, sir.
Now, good evening, everybody. Can you listen to me, madam?
Yes, yes.
Yes. Respected director, respected chief guest, senior faculties, colleagues, friends, participants, and my dear students, it's my privilege to deliver the vote of thanks on behalf of Department of Physiology and all the faculties of AIIMS Guwahati. I want to extend my thanks wholeheartedly to our director, madam, Dr. Geetanjali Padmanabhan, Director AIIMS Bhuvaneshwar, as well as Director AIIMS Guwahati, for the endless continuous support and guidance in all our endeavors right from the inception of our institute. Thank you, ma'am. I want to extend my hearty gratitude to our guest speaker, Dr. Ramesh Bijlani sir. Koti pranam to Mate Aravindo. Then, sir, with all your motivational talk, you have imbibed our young minds who are the budding doctors, especially to make the right choice, and with all the books and the guidelines. Life is a journey, life is a vehicle, inner voice is the driving force, and with suitable examples, how to get joy, how to get the boosting of the immunity. So today's talk, we are very fortunate to hear from you, sir. Thank you so much for joining and giving a wonderful talk for today's afternoon. My heartfelt thanks to our HOD madam, Dr. Manasi Bhattacharji, Professor at HOD, Department of Physiology, also Academic and Administrative in Charge. Madam, as a captain of our department, with her cool, calm and soft-spoken nature, did all the planning and programming for the grand success of this webinar. Thank you, madam. Special thanks to Dr. Abhishek Sinha, Associate Professor, Department of Physiology, for doing all the hard work, rendering the technical support, all the web-based guidance, and to make this webinar as a grand success. Thank you, Dr. Abhishek. I thank to all the faculties of AIIMS Bhuvaneshwar for joining us. I thank all the faculties of AIIMS Guwahati. Right now, we are four departments, and we are the initial faculties, the faculties of anatomy, physiology, biochemistry, community and family medicine. We are like a family, and we are working hard to make our institute to progress and as a prestigious one. I thank all the participants and dear students of AIIMS Bhuvaneshwar and AIIMS Guwahati. Your presence made our webinar a remarkable and memorable one. I thank Department of Physiology faculties. I also thank Nirnay Sharma for playing a patriotic music at this juncture. I thank one and all present in the webinar. I apologize if I have failed to missed anybody. Dear participants, there is a small announcement in the chat box.
Dr. Naveen, sorry to interrupt you. Madam is here. Our director, Madam Gitanjali ma'am, is there in the webinar. Ma'am, please, yes, ma'am. So nice of you to join in. Please say a few words.
I have heard Professor Bijrani a very, very long time ago, I think decades ago. And it's such a pleasure to hear the way he speaks, because I am one of the people who were very inspired by his work, his early work in medical education and, you know, all that. And so I have actually I logged in very late. So Professor Bijrani, from my deepest appreciation, thank you very much on behalf of AIIMS Bhubaneswar and AIIMS Guwahati. Thank you very much for agreeing to give deliver this talk, because I always feel that sometimes we are missing something. And as you have said in your talk, this is perhaps the most important part of the, you know, whole jigsaw which we are missing. And if we are not in a position to tell people or tell the young students what they can be or aspire to be, and we are failing in our mentorship. And so thank you very much for agreeing to speak with our students, the young students. I'm sure I was listening to many of the questions they have asked in the chat box and the answers which you were giving. So that shows that there has been enough interaction. They have listened to you, and that's why they are asking you the questions. Actually, like we always say, that if there are no questions, that means it has gone above your head. So the very fact that they asked questions, I am very happy that they have been interactive. Thank you very much, sir, for agreeing with this. And I also congratulate Mansi and her team for doing this, because yes, we are in a difficult situation. We are doing things online. Students are, you know, we keep grumbling that they have very less attention span, but it shows that so many students have logged in, they have stayed logged in. And so that gives us some hope. So thank you, Mansi, for joining, for organizing this, and all the members of AIIMS Guwahati for this. And of course, Professor Ramesh Bijrani, thank you very much, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Am I unmuted or?
Yes, sir, we can hear you.
Thank you, Dr. Padmanabhan, Mansi, Abhishek, and Naveen. All the other faculty and the students. The faculty created the opportunity and the students gave the opportunity. Opportunity for what? Opportunity for me to fulfill the purpose of my life. As I said, that the purpose of life is fulfilled by giving what you have to those who need it. So I had something to give, and you created the opportunity so that I could give it to those who needed it. Thank you for helping me get that opportunity, and hope to interact with you again sometime in the future. Thank you again.
Thank you, sir.
Dear participants, there is a link in the chat box, which is the link for the Google form for feedback. Kindly share your valuable feedback before logging out. Please click on the link and give your valuable suggestion for today's webinar. Be safe and stay safe. Thank you. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you, sir.